So I used to do this podcast called BizCraft with one of my best friends in the whole world, Carl Smith. And that's been out of production for, I don't know, like 8 years or so. But he was here in town for a conference, and I tricked him into coming in for a podcast. And it was some real fun and deep conversation. He always brings it, and this is just a great conversation about business and life and growth. And I hope you give it a listen and tell Carl I said hi.
Welcome to the Warrior Mindset Podcast. We're your guide as you make your way through life, getting better 1% every day. We believe that life is lived and true victory won through adversity. Nothing easy is ever worth it. We believe in the warrior ethos and support those that choose to walk that path.
Gene, are you okay?
I'm doing fine. Maybe.
I don't know.
We'll see.
I've been talking to some folks. We're worried about you.
This is an intervention. This is not a podcast. It's an intervention.
It's a Gene-ervention.
Gene.
Crawfish.
I don't know. I don't think so.
Crawfish?
Yeah.
That's your last name?
No. That's what I've been called since kindergarten.
Wow.
What name?
Did they know how big you were going to get back in kindergarten? Because they probably wouldn't have called you that.
Probably not. But what nicknames were you called from like young age? Anything that sticks? So I just owned it. And it kind of went away.
My nickname was Casper. Because I was so pale.
Oh, God. That's pretty pale.
Then, that was the worst of it.
Really? Well, then you're a cool guy then.
Well, I mean, I did have a shitty Smitty for a while.
Oh, shitty Smitty. Okay.
That was before I became the specimen in front of you today of manliness that I am.
Shitty Smitty.
That was pretty raw.
Okay.
I did punch a guy once.
Wow.
Just for looking at me wrong.
Just for looking.
He beat the crap out of me.
Oh, God.
That guy beat the crap out of me.
Yeah. That was your first fight?
No.
Okay.
First fight was in fourth grade.
How many fights do you think you've been in your whole life? Like fist fights or whatever?
8 or 9.
Really?
Yeah.
Explains a lot.
No, ask how many I won.
How did you win?
I have no idea.
Okay. Well, I mean, who
now
really
there were
wins?
Some that were broken up before I got a chance to lose.
Yes. Who really
does that count?
Yeah, it does.
Okay. And I did win probably 2.
Okay. That's pretty good, man.
Hey, but you know, I was formerly trained, in Taekwondo. So that really
throw some kicks.
It gave me confidence.
Yes. It'll do that.
And then I would get my ass kicked. Yeah.
Well, it can give you overconfidence.
Yeah. Odor confidence.
Odor confidence.
Yeah. Master Lee did smell interesting.
So tell me a little bit about, for the most part, I mean, you and I did a podcast together for 2 years.
Was that all?
It feels like longer.
It was back when you were doing BizCraft?
Yeah, it's probably more than that, honestly. I forget. It feels like it's about 3 or 4 years.
Was it like over 50 episodes? We didn't get to 100, did we?
We didn't get to 100, but it was like 80 something.
Because
I was just looking at the number of posts the other day.
That's pretty good.
80 something. But we did it like every other week, I think.
I have no idea.
I don't remember either. But I say that just to point out how long we've been doing this.
Yeah. Figure when did we meet? 2007? 2008?
Something like that.
Yeah.
Kind of nuts.
My life changed forever.
Mine too.
Yeah. Yeah, it did.
Yeah, it's been a long time. Been podcasting. Because I remember trying to figure out how to get the video to work. It was like, but you know, you just couldn't do video over the internet back
that's
then.
A vlog,
yeah,
man.
Yeah, it was pre-YouTube.
Oh.
Kind of nuts.
PewTube. No. Okay.
So just yeah, we've been doing this a while. But when we met, you were running a full-on agency with like 20, 30 employees.
Is that right?
Yeah, something like that.
When we first met, was Engine already at that? We had already made that move.
Yeah, you were everybody was remote.
Yeah, that would have been 2008.
Yeah, and you were just starting to do the jellyfish thing.
Yeah.
if you go back and listen to any of those older episodes, the intro is Carl the Jellyfish King.
Oh, that's right. And you were Mean Gene Crawford.
Yeah, so that was the intro.
I remember when Converge was happening, we were at one of the Converges. I walked up and there was this guy in full on African garb. Mm-hmm. And he looked at me and he goes, "The Jellyfish King."
The Jellyfish.
And I was just like, okay.
Who is that?
And I was like, damn straight.
Yeah, of course.
Now I look back at that going, ooh, you know, cash flow will take care of all the concerns of any business model. You just have enough cash coming through.
Yeah,
you can feel really smart.
It's cash flow king, not Jellyfish King.
I wish it was.
Yeah.
It's not right now.
Not right now. Well, so the whole reason you're here is you were at the conference and you were talking about your transition from the digital agency to buying the bureau and stuff. So let's back up. I just want to talk to you a little bit about, because I think there's some value there in terms of this podcast, where we're, you know, talking about how to be leaders and things like that. Yeah. So what was one of the big impetus for you going remote? I mean, what kind of kicked off the whole Jellyfish thing?
Oh,
in general.
Well, I mean, it was that I didn't want to be in charge.
Yeah.
And the idea that I had to tell people what they were going to do, what they were going to work on, just, it didn't feel right to me. It felt like I needed people to choose what they wanted to work on so they would commit to it. And I wouldn't have to babysit because they had said they would do it. And then if somebody makes a commitment like that and doesn't do it, well, they're just not supposed to be there. Mm. But I think that was really it. Like the core team that I had left, and I was going to grow a new team, and I didn't want to put in any kind of hierarchy or any kind of reporting structures. I just wanted people to come in and create great stuff.
Like, what? I mean, why? I mean, that's like the opposite of why anybody ever starts their own business, right? I mean, you didn't want to be a leader. Everybody, it seems like everybody I talk to is just like, I want to be the man, you know?
Yeah, I didn't. I didn't want to be responsible for other people in that way. I didn't want to be the one who had to tell folks what to do. I wanted people to find, I wanted to create a place where people could grow, where they could make mistakes, where they could do all that stuff. And honestly, I also wanted to create a place that I wanted to be at. And if I created a place where the only time people talked to me was when they had a problem, because that's what leadership is a lot of the time.
Yeah, just fixing shit.
Yeah. I mean, every time you talk to somebody, it's because there's a problem.
It's like being a parent.
Right? Now, they might come in and say, hey, this great thing happened. But most of the time, you end up with everybody's fires. Whereas I just thought, you know, what if we just give everybody the ability to put out their own fires? Mm. And it worked.
Yeah.
It worked until it didn't.
Mm. I remember a lot of that. I remember a lot of the conversations that we would have. Like one of the crazy things was you would have the team vote. Well, I don't know if vote's the right word, but like decide if they wanted to work with a client or not.
Yeah, no, that was it. So prospects would come in and they would pitch us.
Back up though.
Okay.
How in the hell would you get a prospect to pitch you?
It wasn't that hard, actually. I would explain to them that if I sent them a proposal and they said yes, that I then would go to my team and say, you have to work on this. This is your next project.
Okay.
And they may have three or four projects at the same time. If you go with a traditional model where somebody is out there grabbing work and bringing it in, it's the whole less than them thing of sales versus production, talent, whatever you want to call it. Whereas if a client told us why they thought we were the right team, then the team could vote and see if they wanted to be a part of it. Now, all that had to happen was two people had to say they wanted it. And then they could supplement that with other people from either the core team or a second layer.
Okay.
And that meant that I would tell the prospect, if you tell me why you think we're on your list, why you think we're going to be the best, then I can go to the team and tell them. And if they say yes, they've opted in. And once they've opted in, they've committed. And they're going to do the best work for you. Would you rather have a team that says, yes, I want to create something awesome for you, or a team that is told you have to have this done by Friday at 5 p.m.?
It's a pretty strong sales.
It fucking worked.
I mean, clients like what? You were just talking like Facebook.
Yeah.
Facebook then, I guess Meta now, but
yeah.
Epic Games. Mm-hmm. What's another? Drop a couple of names.
Yeah. So it was Epic Games. It was Facebook. We had some Microsoft opportunities, but they weren't going to play that game.
Right.
Marriott, Chase. We had a lot of Chase, really big. We did some Disney stuff. It was awesome.
Yeah.
We had a lot of startups. It was.
Oh, I imagine.
They loved it. Like startups who heard that you were going to make them chase you. They loved it because they were in that aggressive. Mm-hmm. They're looking for something different.
Well, yeah. I mean, that's why they're startups. I mean, they're trying to disrupt something.
Yeah. And they wanted a team that was passionate about what they were doing.
That's cool.
Yeah. They weren't checklists. They weren't like, hey, this website has to be done in 2 months. They were like, we're going to die if we don't do this. And we want somebody who's going to be with us that's going to go full force.
That's great.
Yeah.
So why didn't it work? I mean, it did work. It worked really well. Why did it kind of?
Well, the team fell in love with one project.
Okay.
And that project got bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. So we went from having 8 or 9 clients to having 2 or 3. Mm. And as we consistently told new prospects no, we got a reputation that we were hard to work with. And it was well earned. We were hard to work with. Not in the sense of once we were hired, we were pretty awesome. But we just said no a lot more than we said yes. And eventually people stopped asking. At the same time, that really big project went away quickly.
Well, you get done as well eventually.
Yeah. And even though we had like close to $400,000 in the bank, cleared taxes, everything.
Wow.
That was just, we tried to self-incubate some stuff and some other things, but it was just obvious that it was not going to go again. And after a failed attempt to sell what was left, ended up going all in on the Bureau.
Yeah. Well, so you spoke today, you talked about some personal reasons, like some stuff that you just kind of like were kind of burned out, I guess.
Oh, yeah.
Talk about that a little bit, because I think a lot of people struggle with that if they're trying to build something, you know, they kind of go all in and get burned out.
Well, I firmly believe that while you're trying to create something and build something, you're of one mindset. And when you start trying to protect it, you shift to another mindset and you go into a defensive mode instead of an offensive mode. And so I got to a point where we had the team spanned 8 time zones and I felt like I could never be asleep.
Yeah, that's good.
We had people in Australia. So for some people, it was tomorrow. On Sundays, people would be at work because it was their Monday. I had people that were 8 hours behind me and 12 hours ahead of me and all this stuff.
And when they need you, they need you.
Well, and I don't even know that they did, but my brain couldn't let go of the thought that they did.
Well, you're a responsible person. I mean.
Thank you.
Well.
I have a short list of folks I need you to share that with. But no, so it got to this point where I was just like, I am becoming the problem. And, you know, it even happens with the Bureau today, where a few days ago I found myself, I had made too many commitments. I was overwhelmed. And I basically reached out to the 2 people on my team, Lori and Meredith, and I said, hey, apologies if I've been snippy. I have gotten myself upside down with commitments, and I just need a couple of days to get through this. Mm. I've learned that communicating is a good call.
Can be.
Letting people know what you're going through. And so for me, it was like, that was the big takeaway from that moment was, I don't have to do everything by myself. Mm. Everybody doesn't need me all the time. And I look back and I realize we were one of 7 agencies allowed to work with Facebook, and we ended up firing them. We walked away from really lucrative projects because they weren't fun anymore.
Yeah.
And a lot of that sounds like a great rally cry, but I think the big challenge was I put the company and that team in front of my family. Mm-hmm. I didn't think about long-term what our security looked like. Mm-hmm. And I don't make that mistake anymore. Mm-hmm. I make sure that I'm keeping my family front and center, even though my kids are grown now. I want to make sure that I'm able to, first of all, help if they need it. And secondly, not become a burden as they get older. Mm.
Yeah. Yeah, I feel that.
Yeah,
for sure. So you made that transition, right? What happened to the Bureau? I mean, you talk about what you want to talk about, but like, what happened to it? Because you went from that to, I mean, it's a big jump to buying the Bureau of Digital.
Yeah.
So right? There's a lot of stuff that happened there.
So you said what happened from the Bureau to buying the Bureau.
What happened to Engine?
At Engine, got it.
What did you do with it?
Well, so I did try to sell it.
Okay.
And ended up in a not partnered with the not most ethical of people. And then that got turned upside down and ended up owing people money to make good on some things that had happened.
Okay.
So in the end, I sunset Engine. I was just going to close it, but my youngest daughter, who at the time would have been 14 or maybe even younger, maybe 12. Yeah, she was 12. She told me I couldn't close Engine because I told her I started it because I loved her. And it was true. I started that company so I could be home more.
Right.
So I could watch my family grow up.
Yeah.
And be a part of it too. Yeah, yeah. Not just watch.
Well,
Reaper. And I said, okay. And then I thought about it and the Bureau acquired Engine for $1.
Okay.
So I told her, I was like, if Engine is part of the Bureau, is that okay? And she allowed it. But it was important to me because I had said that to her. And right. I did a lot of Engine, and why I started it was very much about having managed madness.
Yeah.
You know, like I knew it was going to be crazy, but I also made some huge mistakes. Just over-focused, buying into all of the, I mean, I'll say it, we had a great reputation and we had a little bit of fame and it was very addicting to be the person at the front of Engine.
Yeah.
At which point I started to drink our own juice a little bit and believe things that now I look back on and go, come on, dude.
Yeah, why did we fire Facebook?
Yeah.
But now it's probably not such a bad idea, but.
No, and I wouldn't have changed those things.
Okay. Well, that's important.
I wouldn't, because I ended up here.
Okay.
You know, and now I'm in a place where I feel like I'm really at choice and I have control over the things that matter to me as much as any of us ever do. And I've been through really bad times and I can look back at them now and compare and contrast where I am now with that. If I didn't have those bad times, I wouldn't know the good times. And the darker, you know, the darker the shadow, the brighter the light. And so that's
quotes, bro.
Just it.
Okay. Hmm. Yeah, it's hard to look back and think like, man, I should have done this, I should have done that, and to kind of feel a certain way about it. But
yeah,
I think it's super important.
But it's
important.
A pendulum, right?
Yeah.
It's always going to shift between the light and the dark.
You've discovered Stoicism.
I did. A lot of people say, Carl, you discovered Stoicism. I did.
I want to get into that a little bit.
From my Roman times.
I want to get into that a little bit, how you came to that. But so how did you then, I mean, so if you've hung around with us, which if some of you listen, I know you know who we are, but we're a couple of idiots. But we know the Greggs. We know you took the Bureau over from those two. How did that come about? Like, tell me that story.
Yeah, so
tell me that story again.
I would tell me the story. You know the one I want. So speaking of story, Greg Story got this opportunity to go to IBM.
I didn't do that on purpose, by the way.
He got this opportunity to go to IBM. And if you remember over a summer, they hired like 2,000 designers because IBM was going to become design centric.
Yeah, yeah.
And he led that charge. He had this opportunity and he wanted to do it. And so he went for it. And then it would have been probably around 2014. Greg Hoy and I were having a burger in Midtown Atlanta right before an event that we had going on. And my wife had a cancer scare.
Mm.
And I told him, I said, there's not enough here at the Bureau for me to be able to take care of what's going on. And we still had our insurance and all that stuff. But I told him, I was like, I think I'm going to have to reboot Engine so that I can get enough money to make sure we're okay.
Yeah.
Based on what they'd found. Luckily, it was a false alarm. My wife was fine. But Greg said, I was going to ask if you wanted to buy the Bureau because I want to reboot Happy Cog. I want to really go all in to see what I can do. Because the Bureau was very attractive and shiny and fun.
Mm-hmm.
And it took our eyes off of the other commitments and companies. And so I said, oh, okay. And so, yeah, we figured out what was amicable.
Mm.
And I bought the Bureau, which is just weird to say, because I don't think, like, I don't feel like I own it. I feel like it owns me, and not in a bad way.
Yeah.
But it's, I serve at the pleasure of the community.
Okay.
You know,
that's a cool way to look at it.
That was it. Yeah. I really do look at it that way too.
That's very cool.
Yeah.
Hmm. So you bought it.
Yeah.
I mean, did that go smoothly?
Yeah, yeah, it went amazingly well. Okay. Greg was very, very gracious in that he let me buy it over time.
That's awesome.
It was kind of a percentage of what we made would go to that payment.
Okay.
And I was able to buy it within a year. I was able to pay off, I think, a little bit early.
So it's a healthy business when you got it.
I wouldn't say it was healthy.
Okay.
I would say I didn't know where to look. And this is nothing that nobody tricked me. I just knew I really wanted it.
Yeah.
And I didn't care. But I mean, the thing about running an events-based company, and you know this, is sometimes when you put an event on sale, it's just to get money to pay for the event that happened earlier.
Yeah.
You know, you're just chasing it.
And yeah.
When I bought the Bureau, I would say we probably had $250,000 in...
Oh, wow.
Like, I went $250,000 of debt, but... It felt like the boulder in Indiana Jones.
Yeah. Well,
growing as we ran.
With events, you wind up having these future obligations.
Yeah.
That you're contractually obligated to do these things.
But it worked. And then I always wanted to be membership community. So that was what we launched pretty quickly. And I mentioned it in the talk. with just over 24 hours, $80,000 came in and it freaked me out.
Yeah.
And so
Speaking of obligations, now I have to do a bunch of shit.
Yeah.
What am I going to do?
What do these people want?
I don't have any ideas left.
So,
yeah.
So I closed it and made horrible decisions after that, but ended up back on my feet because the community gave me a lot of grace and there were fewer people then. So I knew everybody by their name. We're 1,400 people now. I can't know everybody.
Yeah.
But at the time, that love that came in, they weren't buying membership because they wanted something. It was because they wanted to show something. They wanted to show appreciation. Mm-hmm. They wanted to be a part of something that was going to last.
Okay.
And but then we just went back to how we had done things, trying to survive on event event revenue.
And then you made it through the pandemic though.
Yeah. So,
which is coincidentally when I started this show. Like officially, as I was bored out of my mind and sitting around by myself, and I was like, I want to talk to my friends.
Yeah.
So I would just get them on Skype or whatever and record it. And so I kind of started this.
So yeah, the pandemic happened. In March of 2020, we had just gotten back from Owner Summit, which was in New Orleans right before Mardi Gras.
I was there and I got COVID.
Yeah.
On the plane ride home.
A lot of people came back with itchy throats and scratchy eyes.
What is going on?
What's happening? And then in March, we had an event that had sold out. It was at 35 people. And I got a call from somebody who said, hey, can you tell me who's going to be there? And I was like, no.
Yeah.
I said, but I can tell you where they're coming in from.
Yeah.
I said, Seattle and New York are going to be there. How are you feeling? And they said, well, that's ground zero for COVID. I said, I know.
I don't know what to tell you.
But I'm not going to tell them no.
Yeah.
So if you don't want to come, I'll give you a full refund. It's not a problem.
Right.
And then somebody else said, can I see a seating chart? I want to see who's sitting where. And I said, no, but I'll give you a full refund.
Right.
That 35 person event, which was about a $4,000 ticket, if I remember correctly, ended up being 16 people.
Okay.
And we refunded the others.
Damn.
Then after that event, I'm walking on the beach and trying to figure out what I'm going to do. Got a call from David Baker, which was still that call from Baker was amazing. Like, how did he know? And he basically just said that
he's kind of like that.
He could tell that it was not a good time for me. And if he could help, he wanted to.
Okay.
So I ended up spending some time with David in Nashville. And we were thinking through stuff and we contacted Blair and we're just trying to figure out like, how do we move through this? And while we were doing that, the community started to basically take care of itself.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, yeah, tell me about the Slack thing.
So we had 1,600 people in Slack. It was a free instance, and you could only have 10,000 live messages at a time.
Right. Slack deletes your message. That's like after 48 hours.
And it doesn't delete it.
Oh.
It just puts it into an archive that you can never see.
Oh, but you can pay to get it back.
But if you hit paid, then it comes back. So. Okay. Everybody's in there talking about EIDL and PPP, and they're trying to negotiate through work from home, and they're doing all this stuff. through the Bureau Slack.
Right.
But every day somebody will go to reply to a message and that message is gone.
Not there, yeah.
Because there were over 10,000 messages a day going through that Slack.
It's a lot, dude.
And so somebody just reached out to Slack and said, would you turn on the paid version?
That's amazing.
And one day I logged in
and it's just
and saw all of these messages when I did a search. And I was like, what has happened?
Yeah.
And realized that it had gone paid. And I contacted Slack and said, I didn't authorize that. And they said,
right. You're like, I don't want to pay $5,000.
It's free for 2 months. And I said, oh, okay. And they actually extended it out. It ended up being free for 8 months.
Wow.
But what I realized was we can never go back.
Yeah.
People now have tasted this forbidden fruit of these past messages and they want it. And it was going to cost at the time about $2,000 a month.
Yeah.
So I told everybody, hey, it's free right now, but it is going to have to become
paid.
We're going to have to do something. And at the same time, a bunch of requests for membership started coming in. And membership wasn't really a thing. But what had happened was about 20 members from that core original group got together and put out videos on what the Bureau meant to them. And people started wanting to be a part of it. And so I quickly put membership back in place and we started having $10,000, $12,000, $15,000 membership days. And it pulled us right out of that funk, pulled us right out of that hole.
That's cool.
I still get goosebumps and a little teary eyed thinking that I had finally been part of curating an organization that could take care of itself.
Yeah.
And still there's problems and there's issues and you have to tell kids to get out of the pool because they're fighting,
right?
You know, all that kind of stuff. But
right.
During that pandemic, I saw what the Bureau really was.
That's cool.
It was a community that loved itself and wasn't going to let a silly little thing like COVID destroy it.
Do you feel like some of the jellyfish stuff was built like precursor to some of this?
1,000%.
Yeah.
I mean, I created this thing called the Jellyfish Alliance.
I remember that.
And this was where different companies were going to try to work together. But the problem was I had an agency, so I don't think people trusted me completely because obviously I had skin in the game if I'm partnering with others.
Right, right.
But once I got to the Bureau, I didn't have a shop anymore.
So and you're
now
neutral.
I'm able to say, let's work together, and I'm not going to be getting any kind of special treatment or advantage or manipulating others. It's truly just, let's get through this together.
Hmm, that's cool. Did you feel that early on? Like I'm kind of here, I'm like representing the Bureau, but I'm also kind of like running my own business.
No, I never did. It's interesting because I think a truth that I rarely tell myself is that I was not the right person to run the Bureau. And so I tried really hard. And the focus that I put on trying to become the person that could guide a community like this, I think changed who I am inside and allowed me to suddenly be selfless in a way where I could still take care of the people in my life. So I was selfless, but I had an eye on needing to make enough money. And that becomes the biggest challenge, right? When you're trying to lead a life a certain way, you can't act like money doesn't matter because it does, right? And this gets me all the time. I know why. I've been in therapy for about 18 months now. And one of the things we dug into was I have a fear of money. Scared of money. I think money's bad.
Okay. I get it now.
And this was all because of my dad and some of the stuff he went through. I'll sum it up with this. My grandmother left my dad $1 in her will. Because if she had not left him a dollar, he could have claimed that he had the rights to everything, including about 130 acres of property. He did end up getting all of that. He was the only child. But money was held over his head all the time. And so he was scared of it. And so that I became scared.
So he taught you that. Yeah.
He didn't mean to, but yeah.
Well, that's how that works.
So that becomes kind of something. And then now I realize through studying Stoicism, through other means, you know, we say money is the root of all evil, but that's not the quote.
Oh, really?
The quote is the love of money is the roots of all kinds of evil.
Wow. I love misquoted quotes.
It is the love of money that is evil. So, or the root of evil. Money's a tool.
Right.
You can use it to cut. You can use it to create. You can use it for good. You can use it for ill. But you get to choose how you use it. And once I realized that, it became, okay, how can I support others and support myself? Because the other thing I learned, nobody wants me to take one for the team. Nobody wants me to not be rewarded. Mm-hmm. They want the bureau to be healthy. And for the bureau to be healthy, I need to be healthy. So it's really weird.
They want it when they log into Slack, they want it to still be there. I mean, seriously.
And it turns out it will be, even if I'm long gone.
That's awesome, though.
Yeah.
You know, that's funny. We run into that same sort of thought process in the martial arts, people that teach martial arts. This is like I think maybe you can think about it in terms of religion too, where you think that the person who's in charge shouldn't be taken care of. Like they shouldn't worry about that aspect of it, you know?
Right.
You should only be focused on taking care of your community.
Yeah.
Like why are you worrying about money? Like we feel that, but I don't think anyone else thinks that.
See, this really annoys me. The word community has been pulled in to that vast bastardized list of words where you have brand communities.
Mm-hmm.
That's not a community. A community is when a group of people come together with a common interest and a cause, something they want to do. It's not about putting a bunch of people in one location so you can talk to them about new updates to a product, right? There may be a Disney community because people love Disney and they want to talk about it and they want to talk about their trips and things like that. Yeah. I'm cool with that.
Yeah.
But if you have a community for a watch, if these are people who want to talk about what they do while they're wearing the watch, okay. Mm. But if it's just going to start pumping out information on other stuff, communities have to grow and thrive. And I've studied this for a few years now, which I hadn't before, but I now understand that a healthy community is one where people have a place to go, where they can grow, where they can start to contribute, where they can take over. And that's one of the things right now, going into 2025, we have people who are going to be running the events that aren't me.
Yeah, you've been working on that for a while.
I'm terrified and I'm thrilled.
Yeah.
You know, I'm pleasantly terrified.
How do you find, I want to phrase this right so that it makes sense. A lot of times, in martial arts or whatever, we talk about the thing that scares you. It's not just like fear. Let's talk about fear for a second. The thing that scares you is not necessarily the thing that's going to kill you. You should like when you feel that feeling, that might be the thing that pushes you to the next level.
Truth.
Right. Like going through that. I mean, is that sort of like a guiding thing for you? Like when you're thinking about, all right, I want people from the community to put events together and I'm going to be kind of hands off with it. I mean, how are you approaching that? Is it like, this is something that I feel like needs to happen, whether I want it to or not?
Yeah. So wanting to step back from making the decisions is twofold. First, anybody who knows me knows I never wanted to be in charge. So
that was your whole talk today.
I'm still fighting to not be in charge. But what I know about the community is it's a community of leaders and they're going to be able to do this. Right. They're wired for this. So fear, yes. But if you think about fear as an emotion and you back up and you try to figure it out, it's perspective. It's how you're looking at something that might happen, which could just as easily create excitement.
Mm.
Right.
Right. It's all in how you use
it's
it
how you
or
look at it. Yeah. Right. Anxiety versus adrenaline.
Right.
Like I'm scared of jumping off this cliff, but I've got a bungee cord tied to my feet. I'm still scared, but it's going to be so cool.
Yeah.
Right. So like even stepping out on stage and realizing that everybody out there wants you to win, not I'm going to suck today.
Who's waiting for you to fuck up.
Yeah, exactly. It's you have to give yourself this kind of permission to look at the world a little differently. And I think that's it for me. So like, even though, there are going to be events going on and I'm not going to be in that city.
That's pretty weird.
It's also really cocky and ego driven to think that the Bureau needs me.
Hmm.
It does right now, but if I create it and move it into a direction and change the platform, then it won't. And that's all I've ever wanted was to create a self-sustaining entity that can take care of me and my family And somebody asked me, like, where do you see yourself 10 years from now? I said, right here.
Yeah.
I said, I want to be running around the world. Right, I want to trail run all over the place, but I want to be a part of the Bureau community. I said, when I see myself 10 years from now, I'm not making financial decisions. I am just part of the community. I want to step back down and just be a part of what's going on, not make all the decisions.
It's very, it's very stoic.
Well,
it sounds cheesy to like label it like that's a stoic mindset, because it's so much more than that. But is that part of it for you? I mean,
I don't think of it that way.
Okay. Yeah. Well, I mean, it's hard
but
but
I think it is. As I said, 18 months ago when I went into therapy, it was right after I'd had a remarkably bad day.
Okay.
I was in California. It was the Super Bowl the Niners and the Chiefs. And I was in San Francisco with my best friend, Gabe, one of my best friends, sorry, Rob. And we were watching the game and I decided to be off of my phone. I decided I was going to just detox for the day. Mm-hmm. And Gabe asked what the spread was on the game. And I went down to look at my phone and I had 18 missed calls and like 20 texts. My mom had fallen. Mm-hmm. So it was only 3 hours I had my phone off.
Yeah, and it's a lot of guilt.
So angry, and I didn't know how to get across the country because I was my mom's solo provider, healthcare provider, really.
Yeah.
I mean, there were other, she was living in a facility and there were other people, but I was family.
Yeah, we know how the facilities are.
And I got so angry.
Yeah.
And I went for about a 3-hour walk. And I came back and I just started looking for a therapist and I wanted a psychologist. And so one of the things that happened.
Now, your dad was a therapist, right?
He was a psychologist.
Okay, psychologist.
I found out a lot more about him lately, because my psychologist, Eric, on Fridays, he'll ask me questions to ask my mom when I see her on Sunday. Like, hey, ask your mom about why you feel this way.
Wow.
And so it's been an amazing 1-2.
Wow. Okay.
I would say punch, but really 1-2 lift.
Yeah. Okay.
And so, but I go back to that because I think I realized at that point, when I started digging into who I was and how angry I was, that I was just looking at the world wrong. Mm-hmm. I was looking at the world from a perspective that wasn't fair because I was comparing myself with everybody else. And I saw people that started when I started and they were like really well off financially. And I had kind of let my company explode and fall to the ground. And I hated myself for that. Mm-hmm. But once we started digging into it, it was Eric, who my psychologist, Dr. Kiner, who said, you should listen to the Daily Stoic.
Really?
Ryan Holiday's
podcast. So he sent you there.
He said, you should listen to it. Okay. I think you'd get something out of it. And so I started listening to it, and I've listened to it every single day for about 18 months now.
It's funny to hear someone actually prescribe stoicism.
Right? Well, and that was part of what I loved about him. I looked through quite a few different people. And I just got the sense this guy's not going to, ask me about my childhood. Right. He's going to definitely be much more on the try this. One of the things was when I came back, I've never talked about this. When I came back from California, I quit running. Mm-hmm. I started drinking.
Mm-hmm.
I got to this point where I was just like, I want to see where my base level as a human is. If I don't do these coping mechanisms. Running and watching what I eat and being
what do
careful
I turn
with what
into?
I drink and all this kind of stuff. It was not pretty.
Really?
Okay. It was not pretty. And the first call with Kiner, he said, you know, I think you have self-care and coping mechanisms confused. He said, I want you to go home and put on your shoes and go for a run.
Okay.
That is what balances you. That is what makes you feel alive. And so I did. And everything fell back into place. Mm. And so when he mentioned the Daily Stoic, I had to do it.
Yeah.
You know, it's really been a beautiful experience. And then I do all the other self-care things of journaling and, you know, meditation. But before he mentioned it, it's also funny because I'll say things sometimes. He goes, I know you're expecting me to sign off on that behavior. I'm not going to do it.
I'm That's like, good. Okay. Good, honest asshole. Feedback.
What am I paying you for?
So you're a huge runner. I mean, you love to run, but you say you run and you meditate. How do you like, you don't, do you see them as the same thing?
Sometimes.
Okay. How is running not meditation for you?
Well, it depends. Like if I'm listening to music or listening to a book, it may be moments of solace.
Okay. All right.
But it's not focusing on something.
Okay.
But there are times I'll go for runs and I'll put on meditative music.
Right.
And try to solve a problem. Because what I find is once my body gets running, my brain goes, oh, we're going to be doing this for a while.
Yeah.
I'm on kind of autopilot.
Downshift and figure some shit out.
Yeah. And so it does. But for meditation for me, it's definitely a daily affirmations.
Okay.
Reminding myself what matters.
It's like life. Positive self-talk and aligning yourself with your mission.
And also working through different challenges.
Okay.
So I'm actually at a point where I'm starting to record my own meditations because I know who I am and I know the things I need to focus on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Interesting. I've done that. I've just used the phone to just kind of freeform talk about a problem, or usually I will like just kind of rant about someone.
No, there's,
I mean, I have some anger issues too, but I find that if I do that, if I'm like putting it in a recording to where like, it's this idea that this thing could be discovered by that person.
Dude.
And then like, I mean, I'll delete it or whatever, but I feel like released from whatever I'm holding against that person.
Yeah, I think that's fair. And we all know that, you know, when you hold a grudge, you're poisoning yourself, hoping the other person dies.
I am really bad at holding grudges.
You are the worst.
I am really bad.
I was surprised you actually called me. But the thing for me, when I start to think about meditation, when I start to think about journaling, is what you said. It's about getting it out. It's about your brain knowing that you focused on it, so it doesn't have to keep it in an endless loop and bring it back again and again and again.
Do you do that? Do you just loop on things?
Yeah.
I do that too. God, it drives me insane.
And that's when I meditate and I say, okay, let's look at this really hard.
Okay, cool.
Let's accept it and let it go on its way. And if people out there listening meditate or they're into some sort of spiritual thing, it's like, you get this. Some people look at it different ways. One thing I'll do is I envision that I'm watching a busy highway.
Mm.
And the highway, those cars are my thoughts.
Okay.
And a car may slow down and I may get in it. So I may be in the thought. But I always remind myself when I'm meditating, I can get out of this car.
Mm-hmm.
I can get out of this thought. And there are other thoughts. And the reality is I'm the passenger. I am not the car. And once you realize that you are observing and you can step back and say, funny little human.
Right.
Why are you all worked up about that? It's not a thing.
Yeah.
You can't, if you deflect it or suppress it, it's going to come back. But if you hug it and love it and tell it you don't care, it'll dissipate.
That's cool.
It's an ongoing struggle. It's not like a one day thing.
Right. Yeah. Well, yeah. You don't just meditate a little bit and solve all your problems. I mean, it's who you are now.
I mean, the fact that you and I are still friends, I have not solved all my problems, but I'm working on it.
Working on it. Did you read Rick Rubin's book?
I'm not sure.
The Art of Creativity or whatever.
I haven't.
He talks a lot about some meditation. He's got a podcast anyway.
Yeah.
Lots of meditation. And I find that I think a lot of people are full of shit and they like talk about like, they're like, yeah, I meditate. I get up in the morning. Like I hate morning routines. Like I always like your morning routine. YouTube is bullshit. Like I get up in the morning and I meditate and then I drink 8 ounces of cold water and then I cold plunge and smack myself around, whatever. Like people will give meditation lip service, but they'll never talk about how they do it.
Yeah.
Cause they don't do it.
Yeah.
I find that if you do actually practice, you've got some details.
Yeah.
You know, you've got some, you need a metaphor, you need ways to get into it. You know, you need a reason to be using it.
Yeah.
And that's what I find. I don't know if you talk to many people about it, but.
No, I think that's it. And it's interesting, while you were just saying that, this thought came into my head of medication versus meditation.
Mm.
And how we may drink or we may do other things to self-medicate. And I really want this shirt that says medication with the C marked out and a T written by it. Right.
We can make that happen.
I think so.
I have
everybody listening. Go for it.
Yeah. I have Canva.
Yeah. There you go. You're going to be great. But no, I don't think meditation is part of a personal brand. I think it's part of a personal journey.
I love how you put that.
I hate personal brand. It makes me want to vomit.
I know. God, you're a hippie. You're such a hippie.
Yeah, that's my personal brand. So Wild Stallion, they used to call me. My hair was
W-Y. So crazy.
Yeah.
L-D.
Exactly.
Stallion with a U.
That's right.
That's a
Bill and Ted.
Yeah, reference. Thank you. Yeah, yeah, I was waiting for you to. Yeah. So the Stoicism thing. I mean, you were prescribed Stoicism.
Yeah, in a way. I mean,
what made you sort of land on Ryan Holiday's work? If anybody listens to the show, that we talk about Ryan Holiday all the time.
Yeah, no, it was because Dr. Kiner said,
listen to
Daily Stoic.
I can't really think of anyone else that's better than him.
I read The Mountain is the Way. I tried to read Meditations. That's hard. I mean, you got to figure Marcus was writing that for himself. He wasn't writing it for us to read.
Right.
So, but I read about Seneca. I started studying the Stoics. So hearing who they were and realizing a lot of them were just really rich white guys who could afford to be Stoic. But then you have people like Seneca who gets banished to an island because he fell out of favor and then brought back because he was back in favor.
Yep.
And they were all really busy people. They were still managing businesses or the government or whatever, but they took time for this practice.
Right.
And so for me, I was like, being able to look at everything they were trying to accomplish and this belief system, right? Or philosophy, if you want to call it, carried them through it. It should be able to handle my problems. So,
I mean, the collapse of society. Yeah. I mean,
well, yeah. I mean,
if you can get through that stuff,
society collapses.
Well, I think about Marcus Aurelius too. I think about like the issues you develop thinking that you're God. I mean, you know what I mean? Like,
you've read my journals,
but like, holy crap. I mean, you are like the ruler of that world at that time. And everyone's telling you like they accept that you're saying you're God. Well, and he didn't do that. Like, because if I'm not mistaken, he split rulership with his cousin or his friend or whatever it was.
I think that's right.
Something like that. Which is just amazing to think that someone.
Yeah.
With the, like, hey, here's the known world. You now run it.
Yeah.
And you're like, eh, it's too much for me.
And embraced his enemies.
Yeah.
You know, it's interesting because I wouldn't say, like, you look at the Bureau. We don't have enemies. We have very passionate people.
Right.
Who might want to do something that I'm not sure about. And knowing that what I should do is love them and see where they go instead of try to explain to them why that might not work.
Yeah.
Because a lot of the things that happen in the community today are because I didn't try to tell somebody it wouldn't work. It wouldn't work for me. Mm. That doesn't mean it wouldn't work. Yeah.
You just explained all of business.
Pretty much. It's all about the context of who you are and what you're trying to do.
How do you manage? I mean, because things are pretty messed up nowadays with, you know, Democrats, Republicans, left and right. I mean, how do you manage some of that?
Yeah.
Are you sort of like leaning on Stoicism to kind of help teach people? Or are you?
That's a great question. I'm not sure.
I don't think anybody knows how to manage that.
But what I'll say is any healthy community is made up of sub-communities of like-minded folks. Mm-hmm. Sometimes those like-minded folks may have a belief system that's going to undermine the community. That's what I keep an eye out for. Mm. We have, I would say, 20-plus sub-communities in the Bureau.
Yeah, you've got to.
Based on, I mean, 1,400 people, but they're getting together in groups of 20 and 30. And I think it's because they either have the same role or the same passion or the same beliefs.
Right.
So you're going to have, I mean, we have a conservative part of the community. We have a very liberal part of the community. We have a very business focused, I don't give a shit part of the community.
Right.
And honestly, I try to embrace all of them and give them choices for what they can do.
That's cool.
But honestly, it's their community as much as it is mine. And that mindset, I think, is what separates the Bureau from other business communities.
Right.
We're not trying to build something to sell it. We're not trying to build something to maximize profit. We're trying to build something to maximize support.
That's cool.
Yeah.
And it sounds like a little branding speak, but I know you. I know you mean that.
Yeah. It's weird because I struggle to explain what the Bureau is because to me, it's this omnipresent thing.
Well, from day one, I've always been told that a business that's more than, you know, we're not talking about like freelancers or solopreneurs or whatever, but a business with, you know, employees or whatever will always take on the personality of the person in charge.
Yes.
And I mean, kind of like a duh moment. Like, so, I mean, how is that? I mean, is that just an extension of who you are?
I think so.
The where you're putting the bureau, you know?
So I'm not going to say how I feel. I'm going to say what's been told to me, because I think hearing it from other people has more credibility for me personally.
100%.
But what I've been told is that the bureau is the way it is because I fight for the environment, not the people. I fight to create a safe space where, with like the Bureau Oath, you know?
Yeah.
I promise not to share anything a reasonable person would deem sensitive or confidential during our time together. It's that oath is a voluntary verbal non-disclosure agreement that says the conversation we have in this room with these people stays in this room with these people. I've had to escort 4 people out of the community for violating the oath. It's a very serious thing.
But you've shown that you're willing to do that.
Exactly.
And everyone sees that.
And sometimes when you have to, this kind of sucks. I mean, there are some rules. And when those rules get broken, I do a public reminder to everybody, this is a rule.
I've seen that in the Slack channels.
And when I do, I think there is inside people relax a little bit. They realize, okay, somebody is paying attention.
I'm safe here.
Because they don't want to be in charge. They just want to know that somebody's paying attention.
Right. They got enough shit going on.
Yeah. So, and that's the other thing that it took a while to learn is that, yes, I feel like I haven't done something in 2 days, but people aren't sitting there, you know, rapping the table going, where the fuck is it?
Yeah. Right.
You know, they're living their lives, doing their stuff. Right. If anything, the number one reason people leave the community is there's too much going on.
I felt that.
Yeah.
I felt that. Like, I felt like I was like, I got to spend an hour checking up on everything, you know?
Yeah.
Which is cool.
Which is cool, but also it's that signal to noise problem when you get larger. Mm-hmm. And so that's part of what we're looking at is how do we basically fractionalize in a healthy way? Mm-hmm. How do we get to these sub communities that are still part of the core? Mm-hmm. And this is what I really want to focus on, but instead I still have to worry about venue costs and stuff like that. Sure. But it is evolving. The community is taking those things off my plate so I can start to look more on the horizon and where we want to be.
That's cool. It's got to feel good.
It feels terrifyingly wonderful.
Yeah, that's a good way to put it.
Pleasantly horrible.
Yeah, it's cool.
Well, the ego side of me struggles to let go, but the spiritual side of me wants this more than anything. Mm.
Which one's bigger?
I think the spiritual.
Okay.
I think the ego is louder, but the spiritual part of me is ever present. Mm.
The ego is awful damn loud, isn't it?
Oh my God. Mine is so big, dude. That was just my ego.
Well, man, I have a gift for you.
What?
Yes, I have a gift for you.
Gene, put your clothes on.
I don't know how we do this on camera, other than I'm just going to hand it to you. So I got this. Not from Ryan Holiday, but at an event where Ryan Holiday was at.
What, dude?
And I carried it in my pocket, not every day, but when I do things.
Your prison wallet or your
prison pocket? But I want you to have that. I want you to look at it. So,
oh, it's inside. Is it a Memento Mori coin?
Yeah.
Oh my God!
So there you go.
Dude, thank
you're
you
welcome.
So much.
Welcome.
I got goosebumps.
Good. I know that you've come to connect with that. So
yeah, I really have.
I wanted to share that with you.
And thank you.
You're welcome.
It's interesting. I had the day that I took the walk on the beach in Charleston, I found this rock, right? And it was a really interesting stone that had been smoothed by the ocean. And I couldn't figure out the story of it. But Baker called right after I had that rock and I started rubbing it. And it felt like a good luck charm. And when I was driving to Atlanta for an event, I almost got in a huge crash and I had the rock in my hand. Ooh. And I somehow avoided everything and ended up in the median, but my car untouched. And I just looked at the rock and I was like,
whoa. I will carry you from now on.
Well, and then I lost it a month later. But
it's heartbreaking.
I think it was time.
And
so this coin right now for me is going to replace that
rock. Thank you.
So Gene, seriously, you're thank welcome. You so much. I am.
And
I'm overwhelmed.
I love that we actually sat down in person. We've done this for years over the internet. It's really weird.
Yeah, it is.
I'm just pretending you're on screen.
The lack of pants
Yeah, I know. Yeah, well, all right, man. Thank you.
Gene Crawford, I love you, and I'm so glad you're in my life.
Love you too, my friend.
I was just joking. Thank you.